Hello students, today we are going to start optic neuritis and we'll also be taking up your lecture 4, that is patrodema, in the same setting. So beginning with optic neuritis. Optic neuritis, today we are going to learn about the inflammation, causes of optic nerve inflammation, signs and symptoms, investigations and so what do you mean by optic neuritis? So optic neuritis is the inflammation of optic nerve. It can be further divided into or it can be classified according to the ophthalmoscopic picture of the optic disc. So ophthalmoscopically what you see is changes, and if these changes are seen then we can divide them into papillitis and neuroretinitis. Papillitis, that means changes that can be only seen on the disc, and neuroretinitis, in which the changes of the optic neuritis can be seen both in the optic nerve or optic disc as well as the retina. In cases of retrobulbar neuritis, the changes are not seen in the optic disc, but there would be signs and symptoms of optic neuritis, but you can't see those changes because the inflammation is behind the laminar portion of the optic nerve. Again with retrobulbar neuritis, this is because it is the most common type of optic neuritis. It's most commonly occur in adults. The optic disc appears normal initially, but later on it can be associated there could be certain changes that are also seen on the optic disc. It could be associated with multiple sclerosis. Second is papillitis. Papillitis means inflammation of the optic disc which we can see ophthalmoscopically. Here what you see is inflammation. Because of inflammation, the disc margins are blurred. You cannot see the optic disc margin, the circular optic disc margin. You are not able to see. What you see is the swelling of the optic disc, the feathery like structure here. This is because of the edema of the optic disc. The margins are blurred. A clear cut margin is not seen. Other things which you are able to see is some hemorrhages on the optic disc. Then we can have flame shift hemorrhages on the optic disc. The vessels are tortuous and fully filled. Then we can have cells in posterior vitreous. This is the most common type in children, but it may also affect adults. So retinitis. What happens is in neuroretinitis that there is inflammation in the disc as well as inflammation seen in the macula. So here what you see is inflammation on the disc as well as on the retina. So here we have star shaped infiltrates or exudates in the retinal nerve fibers. It's the least common and it's usually not associated with any disease. Coming to the etiopathogenesis of optic, it's usually idiopathic. No reasons can be found in any systemic examination. Others could be demyelinating disorders like multiple sclerosis, or it could be because of Devic's disease. There could be infectious and parenchymal, then immune mediated as in cases of SLE, polyarthritis nodosa. So in these immune mediated diseases, what happens is that there is an ischemia. As you know that in this immune mediated vasculitis, there is a ischemia because of vasculitis, and they may produce, and because of this there could be demyelination or axonal necrosis. Then it could be because of sarcoidosis and metabolic disorders like diabetes, anemia. So optic neuritis can be seen in these disorders as well. So clinical features, it is usually unilateral, but it could be bilateral. In retrobulbar neuritis, it is usually associated with local tenderness. It could be deep orbital or retroocular or brow pain, usually aggravated by eye movements. That is seen along with retrobulbar neuritis. This I had already told in your class in anatomy, that this pain in eye movements is because the optic nerve is close to the insertion of the extraocular muscles at the annulus of Zinn. So if there is a retroocular inflammation, the annulus of Zinn is affected, and because of which there would be a pain in the eye movement. Then there will be neuralgia, there could be neuralgia and headache. Further, there could be loss of vision, especially color vision, and the color vision which is affected most is red desaturation. To see if the color vision is affected, you can use some red color object in front of the patient. So if the patient, when he sees that object with a normal eye, he can see a red color, but when normal eye is closed and the patient is trying to see the object with the diseased eye, the desaturation, he can see the decrease or a faded red color. That is because of the red desaturation, there could be reduced, plus there could be reduced perception of light. Sometimes these visual acuity disturbances could also be associated with altered perception of moving object, that is known as pulpric phenomena. So what happens in altered perception of moving object, or to demonstrate it, what we can do is the pendulum test. So pendulum test, what we do is we hang a pendulum in front of the eyes of the patient and ask him to see the movement of the pendulum. So when he sees that moving object, so instead of a to and fro movement of the object, what he is able to see is an elliptical motion of the pendulum. That elliptical motion is because of the altered visual potentials from the diseased nerve. And this altered motion is known as pulpric phenomena. There could be worsening of symptoms with exercise or increase in body temperature, is known as Uphoff's sign. The signs which we can see in this optic neuritis would be decreased visual acuity. So decreased visual acuity, it can range from small decrease in visual acuity, or it could be like perception of light. There would be decreased color vision, abnormal contrast sensitivity, decreased stereo acuity. One of the important things to elicit in case of optic neuritis is pupillary action. So we have to look for relative afferent pupillary defect or Marcus Gunn pupil. There could be visual field defects as well. Various visual field defects that is more marked in the central field. So beginning of the visual acuity or the visual loss, that's a very important sign for optic neuritis. It can be subtle or it can be profound. That is, there may be complete blindness in some patients, or it could be diminution of vision. It's usually unilateral, the decreased visual acuity, but it can also be bilateral. Typically it affects people between 18 and 45 years of age. There could be orbital or retroorbital or brain pain, which is usually aggravated by eye movements, especially in cases of retrobulbar neuritis. And this eye pain, this can only be, or neuralgia, this can only be seen in initial stages of retrobulbar neuritis. So history taking is very important in these cases. Visual acuity defects, what you can see in optic neuritis, it could be arcuate defect, altitudinal field defects, double arcuate defects. So we have this arcuate defect here. So altitudinal field defects, double arcuate defects, upper and lower field defects. Then we have an enlarged blind spot, the central vision loss and centrocecal vision loss. Then we have a paracentral vision loss, nasal step, and a quadrantic vision loss. So almost all type of central visual losses are seen in retrobulbar neuritis. There will be a normal disc, the vessels are also normal, macula is normal. In cases of papillitis, there would be a swollen disc along with other features like hemorrhages, there will be tortuous and filled veins, And in cases of neuroretinitis, there would be a disc changes and along with them, there would be a macular changes or retina nerve fiber layer changes also showing like a stellate pattern of retinal exudation. Now coming to the differential diagnosis, so all those cases in which there will be disc edema coming to the differential diagnosis of optic neuritis, like ischemic optic neuropathy. But ischemic optic neuropathy occurs in an elderly population above 50 years of age. Papular edema, again, could be, it is associated with disc edema, but that would be loss of vision, loss of central vision is late in cases of papular edema. So that can be a, that will be a differentiating sign from papular edema. Grade 4 hypertensive retinopathy, again the decrease in vision and decrease in color vision is less in case of grade 4 hypertensive retinopathy. Leber's hereditary optic neuropathy, it comes in differential diagnosis. Any compressive space occupying lesion, either in the orbit or in the brain may cause papular edema, which will cause disc edema. So all those will come under the differential diagnosis of optic neuritis. Ophthalmoscopic signs of on the disc, the patient may not be able to diagnose it, because you may think that the patient may be hysteric or he may be feigning to have a decrease in visual acuity, since we are not able to see any abnormality in the disc and the macula. Then color vision, pupillary reactions. Pupillary reactions are very important in cases of optic neuritis, as you know. So any case in which the optic nerve is affected, there would be an efferent pupillary defect. So we have to see for efferent pupillary defect or RAPD, retinal examination to see for the disc and the macula. Investigations that are required are the visual fields. As you have seen, there are a lot of visual field defects, especially the central visual field defects that are seen in the optic neuritis. Then visually evoked potentials, atypical optic neuritis. So in atypical optic neuritis, the age may not be the correct age for optic neuritis. It may be beyond the regular age for optic neuritis, or it could be in certain other diseases associated with certain other diseases. In those cases, we go for special tests like CBC, CRP, ESR, fluorescent treponemal antibody absorption test, for it and MRI. MRI is for typical as well as atypical cases also to rule out multiple sclerosis. Now, after investigations, we go for the treatment. Treatment is usually in the underlying cause. If we are able to find the cause of optic neuritis, we first treat the cause of optic neuritis, and the recovery, visual recovery, will depend upon how good we can treat the primary cause. But if it is idiopathic, then the guidelines were given by the ONTT trial or the optic neuritis treatment. So according to the ONTT trial, if there is a profound visual loss with no previous history of optic neuritis or multiple sclerosis, and on MRI what you can see is at least one area of demyelination, in those cases we start treatment with intravenous methylprednisolone. That is 250 mg intravenously slowly over 30 to 60 minutes, repeatedly 6 hourly for 3 days. That means 250 mg 4 times a day for 3 days, a total of 1 gram per day for 3 days, followed by oral prednisolone 1 mg per kg per day for 11 days. And this oral prednisolone has to be tapered off rapidly in the next 3 days. And this treatment, so what is the use of this treatment? This treatment hastens recovery and decreases the recurrence of optic neuritis. In cases MRI is normal, still we follow all of oral prednisolone. As such, if you have to treat optic neuritis, you have to give intravenous methylprednisolone. Observation in cases of previously diagnosed multiple sclerosis, or there had been previous episodes of optic neuritis, that is this episode what you are treating is the third or fourth episode, and in those cases there is no role of intravenous methylprednisolone. So the next lecture is on papilledema. It finishes our optic neuritis. In optic neuritis, what is important is the loss of visual acuity, that is signs and symptoms, loss of visual acuity, then how the visual acuity progresses, and the ONTT trial. Next is papilledema. It's important both in cases of ophthalmology as well as in other systemic diseases. So today we are going to learn about the causes and its treatment. The disc is swollen, elevated. The pupillary reactions are normal. Initially the pupillary reactions are normal. Remember, in papilledema the optic nerve is normal initially. It's only in case of long standing papilledema that there would be changes in an optic nerve. So initially pupillary reactions will be normal in case of. Etiology is primary and metastatic intracranial tumors, hydrocephalus, pseudotumor cerebri, subdural hematomas, arachnoid hemorrhages, brain abscess, meningitis, encephalitis, cerebral venous thrombosis or CVT, and malignant hypertension. Goes into a stage of atrophy. You see is here, if you see a normal eye, so what you can see is a normal eye. Here is a normal optic disc. So you remember in the anatomy of optic nerve, we have told you that the optic nerve, as soon as it comes out of the eye, it is covered by the dural sheets. So here are the dural sheets, subdural space. So in papilledema, what happens is that CSF comes into this subdural space. It is in communication with the subdural space of the brain. So it comes into this subdural space behind the optic nerve. And when it comes into this space behind the optic nerve, it causes pressure on the optic nerve. And because of this pressure, there is swelling of the optic nerve here. So you see, usually the nerve has the extraplasmic flow is from here to here, but since it is pressurized here, there is a stasis in this portion, and because of which what you can see is a bulging optic disc. So here is a normal optic disc when you see through a ophthalmoscope, normal fundus, and here is a bulging optic disc because of papilledema. Symptoms are generally absent or vague. Vision may be unimpaired for long. There could be transient blurring of vision or blackouts, which are increased because of sudden change or posture, like while changing from sitting or lying position. Headache, double vision, nausea and vomiting. So these are all signs of increased intracranial tension. As in papilledema, the headache, nausea, vomiting are signs of increased intracranial tension. So this papilledema can be divided into early, established, chronic and atrophic papilledema. So, and then the temporal blood disc margin. So here what you see is a well-defined normal optic disc. Here what you see is slight blurring of the disc margins here and here. Then there would be loss of venous pulsations, but that's not a very pathognomonic sign of papilledema. In some cases, in about 10-15% patients of normal patients also, there could be an abscess in this pulsation. There could be a splinter hemorrhage and blurring of the nerve fiber layers. We have dilated veins here. So these are the signs of established papilledema. Next is the chronic stage. So in chronic stage, we have we cannot see a disc margin at all. What you can see is a very blurry disc margins with hemorrhages, exudates. These are the exudates which have come into there. The cup is obliterated. There is nothing called a cup. What you can see, nothing like there. What you can see are some blood vessels coming out and a champing cork vessel. Now if the papilledema extends for a long period of time, the optic nerve starts to degenerate, and what we can see is an atrophic stage of papilledema. So here what you see is that the hemorrhages, they dissolve, the disc becomes green color, there would be some new gliosis or fibrotic appearance of the disc, fibrosis of the disc. This hyperemia disappears, it would be a pale color disc. Then there could be some optociliary shunts here, that is extra vessels which may come up on the disc. This is known as optociliary shunt. Papilledema is usually bilateral. The amount of swelling may be significant in localizing the lesion. Usually in frontal tumors and middle ear disease, the swelling is more prominent on the side of the lesion. The time of onset of papilledema is more important than the amount of swelling. That is, if it appears in the right eye first, that means the disease is in the right eye, because later on, after some time, it will appear on both eyes, or there would be disc edema in both the discs. One important point is a Foster Kennedy syndrome. What happens in Foster Kennedy syndrome is that there will be unilateral papilledema with or without optic atrophy on the other side. That means usually it is associated with optic atrophy on the other side, suggests a tumor of the opposite olfactory groove or orbital surface of the frontal lobe or the pituitary body. That is because first if the optic atrophy has developed and then papilledema has developed because of the tumor, then once the nerve is atrophied, then there won't be any papilledema seen on the disc. So that's why it may be unilateral papilledema. So differential diagnosis, it could be pseudopapilledema, papillitis, hypertensive retinopathy. And again, in all these cases, there would be a disc edema, central retinal vein occlusion, infiltration of disc, diabetic papillopathy, orbital optic nerve tumors. In all these cases, what you can see is that disc appearance will be the same, but well with difference. If you take the history and other systemic examinations, there will be difference in history and systemic examinations. One important is differential diagnosis is benign intracranial hypertension. So history is very important in cases of optic neuritis. History along with symptoms, physical examination, especially in cases of with changes in visual acuity, there could be diplopia because of the paralysis of sixth nerve as the intracranial pressure rises. Blood pressure to rule out hypertensive or optic neuropathy, hypertensive neuropathy or retinopathy. Ocular examination, see for the movement of the eyes, relative apparent pupillary defect, rule out optic neuritis, retrobulbar neuritis. Color vision, color desaturation test, these are all affected initially in case of optic nerve diseases, but not in cases of papilledema. Visual fields, so what visual field defects you can see in optic neuritis of papilledema is the bearing of the blind spot. So that is because of initially when there is a swelling of the disc margins, there would be blind spot, the area of the blind spot will increase because of swelling. That is the first sign that we can see on the visual field in case of papilledema. Then we have to do an emergency MRI to rule out any cases of intraocular tumors or increased CSF pressure, or CT scan. In case of benign intracranial hypertension or pseudopapilledema, we have to see for the CSF pressure. For that, we have to do a lumbar puncture, usually by a neurophysician. Treatment is as the optic nerve itself is not involved, it's a passive swelling of the optic nerve. The treatment is disease of the treatment of optic nerve shunt is required, excision of the tumor, or any optic nerve shunt required in cases of hydrocephalus, that has to be done. And then the papilledema will decrease If the papilledema decreases in the early stages, then the optic nerve function can be restored. But if the papilledema stays for a long period of time, then there would be an axonal degeneration and the optic atrophy sets in. So this finishes our as well. Thank you.